And a lot of folks have been praying for rain, and just you got to watch what you pray for. We got about 12 drops. So I think the prayers were answered, but sometimes we have to be just a hair more specific in what how much rain, because then we get the other version too, you know, 7 or 8 inches. So kind of a happy balance, Lord, please. Anyway, I'm here to just talk announcements real quick before I turn it over to the stars of our show, our program. I don't want to say that word because I've been warned about that one. But anyway, as far as what's going on this week, let's see. We start off with the thrift store, of course. I didn't mention that last week, so we skipped it a week. It is there. We're here every Tuesday. We're Tuesday through Saturday, and we've got a lot of good things in the store. We've also always looking for other materials that we can take to the store and sell and use it for the benefit of Reach Church and our missions and the things that we're using. Men's prayer breakfast, it is on Monday, which is tomorrow. Potbelly Deli, 7 o'clock in the morning. So men, please be there. Ladies, I heard somebody talking a while about even crashing the party, but our recommendation is just come, but set up another table, have a little ladies' breakfast. But please, ladies, get yourselves together, too, and have a little bit of ladies sharing the word of Christ and your issues and your concerns and so forth. Let's see. Anything else on this magic thing? Bingo. Bingo. That's Tuesday. And all of the proceeds, Tuesday's bingo here at Archie's, thanks to Patty, are here to benefit Reach Church. So we're very much thankful for that. Thursday's Bible study, Ophelia has that, but we need to contact her, and I don't see her today to wait. She is floating here. Okay, good. Not more than floating, but she's here. Is that Hey Opie? Is that what I say? Okay. Anyway, she's busy over there. But last thing I have to say real quickly is just Mark Woods. He's off the ventilator now. So there's a definite improvement. So let's thank the Lord for that. And with this, I'm going to real quickly turn it over to Dave because he wants to talk about a truck. And then we're going to be on to the singing.
Thank you, Jim. All right, so Jim mentioned, and there's the lady of the hour right now. Jim mentioned that Tuesday night bingo benefits the Reach Church and Thrift Store, and then for several months over the last year, Patty McGee, the owner of Archie's, steered a bunch of funds over to the store for the intent of buying a box truck, so I don't have to beat my little Saturn up with my trailer. And I want to let you know, we went and picked up the truck this week. We got a great deal on it. We bought it from Pressure Pro. And the original owner and starter of the company of Pressure Pro, I've known for a few years. I know he takes care of his equipment very well. We got a 2012 Chevy box truck with a 16-foot box on it. It looks like new. The interior is clean, sparkling. It smells new still inside. And he sold it to us for $7,500. Everybody who's seen this truck has seen it for $11,000 or $12,000. But I want to tell you about this. Patty, every penny to purchase the truck, to cover the first year's insurance, and to register it was in place because of that lady right there. That truck was afforded by the thrift store because of Patty. Thank you so much. It's going to save my back an awful lot of work. Thank you. It's such a blessing to be part of this community, and it's really funny because people who don't know us, they go, you know, you're really kind of a, you know, Archie's is really special to you. And I said, yeah, Archie's is really special to us, and the church is really special to Archie's. We've been here going on our 12th year now, and we talk about it occasionally. We started with 7 people underneath that little lean-to over there. We were talking about it today because we have a skeleton crew here. Which, thank God I lost the weight or I wouldn't be part of it. But we started almost 12 years ago, 11 and a half years ago, and Paula and I were singing a cappella with 7 people, and we were just opening up with a couple of songs, and we'd pray, and we'd do a little church service, and it went from 7 to 12 to 30 to 45, and here you are in the middle of this summer heat, and if you didn't come out here in the heat, I could stay home. But it's okay. In season, there's over 400 people here on the deck. And that's what God does when you just feed people truth. When you feed them something that they're hungry for, they're going to come looking. So as we do this morning, today's message, I've been over it. Bob does the study through the week, and we look at it and collaborate. this stuff right here that we're talking about and this right here today, I want you to hear this. The words that God said about Jesus when Jesus went to John the Baptist to be baptized, the first spoken words on the earth were to John, and he said, "This is my beloved Son in whom I am well pleased. This is my beloved Son in whom I am well pleased." When we get to the end of this message, I want you to keep that quote in mind, because everything that is Jesus is you as a believer. You are his beloved child in whom he is well pleased. And we're going to discover why when we go through today's study. So let's open up with this word of prayer. And then I was going through the songs practicing this morning. And it's like I picked the songs without thinking about the message. And I know Bob picks the message because we have a plan. And always the songs just go right in with the message. It's amazing how God handles it. Even when I pick the songs out 2 weeks in advance, it just happens. So Heavenly Father, Lord, for all the blessings that you have in our lives, help us to see all the blessings. Help us to stop whining and complaining about the little things we think we deserve more of, and to just be thankful for all the blessings. Something as simple as having a cold glass of clean water. 90% of the people in the world can't even imagine what that's like. Something as simple as our next breath. Something as simple as the beautiful clouds that you place in the sky. For all that you do in our lives that make every breath worthwhile, we come today to worship you and to praise you. In Jesus' name, amen. All right. Onwards and upwards. We're going to start off with one of my mom's favorites. I got to sing it at her funeral. But my mom was a huge influence in my life, and she plugged in faith into my heart, and it didn't blossom for over 20 years. But when it did, bam, God's good.
Stood an old rugged cross, the emblem of suffering and shame. And I love that old cross where the dearest and best for a world of lost sinners was slain. So I'll change. Suffered and died to pardon and sanctify me. To the old rugged cross I will ever be true, its shame and reproach gladly bear. Then he'll call someday to my home far away, where his glory forever I'll share. So I'll cherish the old rugged cross till my trophies at last I lay down. I will bring
word for our orchestra, Mark Donnelly. I especially love the triangle in there. That was great. Thanks.
Some people try to listen to the bottom of a bottle. Some people try to listen to a needle in their arm. Some people try to listen to money in their pocket. Some people try to listen to another's arm. You and I are not that different. You got a board and we're just trying to fill it up. Something that we give just a little piece. All we want is a hand to reach to. Open arms and say I love you. We give anything to hear the voice of the Savior. Ah, the voice of the Savior. Some people try to find it with blind ambition. Some people try to find it where no one else is gone. Some people try to find it in crowds of victory. Some people get defeated and lose the strength to carry on. But you and I are not that different. We got a board and we're just trying to fill it up. Something that'll bring just a little peace. All we want is a hand to reach you. Open arms and say I love you. We give anything to hear the voice of the Savior. Some people try to find it in the shadow of a steeple. Some people try to find it in a back row pew. Some people try to find it in the arms of Jesus. That's where I found it. How about you? And you and I are not that different. We got a board and we're just trying to fill it up. Something that'll bring just a little peace, yeah. All we want is a hand to reach you. Open arms that say I love you. We give anything to hear. You and I are not that different. We got a board and we're just trying to fill it up. Something that'll give just a little peace, yeah. All we want is a hand to reach to. Open arms and say I love you. We give anything to hear the voice of the Savior. Oh, the voice of the Savior.
Short intro. Short
intro. I know why I picked all these low songs.
Everyone needs compassion, a love that's never failing. Let mercy fall on me. And everyone needs Savior, the hope of nations. Savior, He can move the mountains. My God is mighty to save. He is mighty to save. To save forever, author of salvation. He rose and conquered the grave. Jesus conquered the grave. Savior, He can move the mountains. My God is mighty to save. He is mighty to save forever, author.
One more before the message. This one's fun. Let's have some fun.
Jesus is alive and well. Jesus is alive and well. Tell everyone you see, tell him from me. Jesus is alive and well. He's seated with the Heavenly Father. Interceding for you and me. Tell everyone you see, tell them from me, that Jesus is alive and well. Now go tell your kings and your president's men, the coming of the Lord is nigh. You better get your house in order. Yeah, He's gonna split the eastern sky. Get the message out to the people. Let's tell it while it's time to tell. Yeah, the Son of God is coming, hallelujah. Jesus is alive and well. Jesus is alive and well. Jesus is alive and well. Tell everyone you see, tell them from me. Jesus is alive and well. He's seated with the Heavenly Father. He's interceding for you and me. Tell everyone you see, tell them from me. Jesus is alive and well. When they nailed my Jesus to that old cross, the devil danced around with glee. He thought he
he had the children of God, and he would take them and throw them into the fiery sea. Well, next day the stone was rolled away, and the angel said, Mary, go tell. Well, the Son of God is risen, hallelujah. Jesus is alive and well.
Jesus is alive and well. Jesus is alive and well. And tell everyone you see, and tell for me, that Jesus is alive and well. He's seated with the Heavenly Father. He's interceding for you and me. And tell everyone you see, and tell them for me, that Jesus is alive. Jesus is alive and well. Tell everyone you see, and tell them from me, that Jesus is alive and well. He's seated with the Heavenly Father. He's interceding for you and me. Tell everyone you see, and tell them from me, that Jesus is alive and well.
Gotta love the ones with some extra life in them, don't you? All right. Thanks, girls. The skeletons. Pastor Dave and the skeletons. All right. Whew. So remember I said how all these songs, like, fit right into the message? We're actually going to talk about how Jesus is interceding or intervening. He's talking to God about us. And I love the book, The Shack, because it talks about what it's like. I know, no kids today? No kids today. All right. Wendy's a kid all by herself, so. If your kids are here, tell them to come over and bother her. But it's interesting that in the book, The Shack, we kind of think like God's the boss. And then Jesus is kind of next in line, and then the Holy Spirit has its job in there somewhere. But it's interesting in that book that the characters that were playing, the spirit, the God and the spirit and the son, they kind of were like laughing when this guy said, well, isn't God the boss? And they're like, no, we're in relationship. Nobody's the head of the other. And then he relates that to, he says, that's kind of what we want for you. We want you to be in relationship with us. We're not your boss. We're in a relationship. We want what's best for each other. And that's kind of what God has always wanted, and I'm discovering it more and more, that he just wants what's best for me all the time. And he wants to lead me to good things. And he wants to help me get through the difficult things. There are going to be difficulties. The Bible says it this way. He says, and when the storms come, and it goes, comma, and there will be storms. You're going to have storms in life. And the Bible isn't about avoiding the storms. It's about walking through the storms securely, knowing that you're going to get to the other side and everything's going to be fine, because God's plan is bigger than anything that's going on here. So as we go through this, we're in Romans chapter 8. We're looking at part 2 of what's called the spirit life. What does it mean to be in a spirit life? Well, Jesus lived on the face of this earth. He only did what Dad said to do. He only said what Dad said to say. And that's how he lived here in the flesh without sin. He was totally trusting God 100% of the time. Our issue is this nasty stuff right here, the flesh. Our issue is we trust our experiences over God. We tend to go with our own thinking instead of God's thinking. And we go, yeah, well, I know God's got that figured out, but I think I got a better plan. And that's why it doesn't work. Pastor Bob?
Don't forget your water.
Yeah,
if
well,
you want.
The only way you're drinking out of my glass.
That's why I said, I don't want to drink out of your glass. Good morning. It's interesting that Dave started talking about hardships, because that was kind of on my mind. I had mentioned last week, I just started a book by Corrie Ten Boom about her experience in Holland under the Nazi occupation. Her father was a watchmaker, and her older sister and her lived with her parents. Her mother died. And she thought she was going to have the mundane life of helping her father with the shop, taking care of her parents. Another sister and brother were married, but they were going to be the ones to take care of mom and pop. And, you know, middle age come around, it's just going to be a sort of a coasting kind of life. And then they got involved. When God gets you involved, when you're willing to be used by God, life changes. And life for her changed dramatically as she got involved with the Dutch resistance, specifically hiding Jewish people who would have been sent to the death camps. And I don't want to give the book away, but her story's well known. She got caught. The Gestapo came in. They did not find, they searched the house. The hidden room was so hidden. They did not find the Jewish people that were there at that time. However, she was sent to a Dutch prison that was now run by the Germans, and from there, a labor camp. And if you think Rock Road's bad, wow. If you think a labor camp's bad, well, spend a few months there and then get herded to the cattle cars, like cattle, jammed in and sent to a German concentration camp for women. And this, what's so incredible about the story is that every time she saw somebody that she thought that she should pray for that was struggling in this insane environment of a concentration camp, and she told her sister, who miraculously was with her at that time in the camp, and she'd say, Bessie, we need to pray for them. And her sister would say, you're right, we do. And then her sister would start praying for the German guard, the female guard that used the strap. The ones that Corey couldn't find herself praying for didn't come into her mind, she said, to pray. And they started having Bible studies in the concentration camp. And her sister said to be thankful for everything, Christ said. Be thankful for everything. And she said, even the fleas? And she said, even the fleas. She said she couldn't bring herself to thank God for the fleas at first. And later she realized that the one room, the big dormitory, as you would, where they were crammed in there sleeping on pallets, that the guards would not come into was that room because of the fleas. And that's where they had the Bible studies, because she was able to hide a Bible on her person. She wore it on a little string around her neck and dropped it down her back. And she said it was God's provision, because they lost so much weight and they were so skinny, it looked like a hump on her back, this little Bible. And they were so thankful to have the Word of God. Another book I'm reading right now said one of the primary ways that we're going to hear God is through His Word. He speaks to us through His Word. And Ophelia and I were just talking about it. Portions of the Bible studying for teachings and for preaching that we thought, well, maybe we'll skip past this section. And then God slows you down and you find out there is so much there. We get in a big hurry. That's the way this modern Western culture is, that we hold up, you know, the American dream, but it's turned into this thing where we're just rushing all the time, and we don't take time to be still and to hear God speak into our lives. So as we continue in 8, we're going to overlap just a little. In verse 12, Paul reminds us that we're not debtors to the flesh to live according to that old way, to live according to those fleshly desires that once controlled us, because we're not our flesh anymore. In the Spirit, God gave us this brand new identity, and we have the spiritual identity, okay? And the soul, you Alpha students may remember this, the soul is like that contact point between the spiritual and the physical life that we live. How does God speak to us? See, we hear each other through vocal cords being moved, and then the air waves being moved, and then your eardrum being moved, and then that being sent to your brain, and your brain filtering and interpreting what that means. This is how we physically contact. God usually doesn't speak in an audible, out loud voice. That's pretty rare. It's happened in the Bible. Dave mentioned that. But he speaks to us spiritually in our minds. See, the mind is the contact point. That's why you've heard before that the battle is for the mind. It's what you're thinking and believing that drives your behavior and mine. So, are we believing and thinking the truth? Do we even pick this book up called the Bible? Do we even pick it up and read it for ourselves and see what God has to say? Or do we focus on hearing all the noise and minutiae and trivia and information overload that we're bombarded with social media, Facebook, Twitter, the news and what they want to tell you and the advertisements and other people? How much percentage of the time do we even try to listen to the master of the universe? Our Savior who conquered the grave so that we could have life with him forever. That forever began not when you die and go to heaven. It began, see, past tense, when you first believe and that spiritual identity was birthed. That's when eternity began. And that's why he said, you're not debtors to the flesh. For if you live according to the flesh, you will die. But if by the Spirit you put to death the deeds of the body, you will live. By the Spirit, God's Spirit, living in us in union with our spirit. For you did not receive the spirit of bondage again to fear, but you received the spirit of adoption into the family of God, by whom we cry, Abba, Father, Dad. Like newborns reaching out, needing that comfort, needing that security, needing that knowing you're going to be okay. Maybe when you were little and you were scared, you look for mom or dad, right? Little children, man, they turn around. They want to know where their parents is. They want that contact. We have that contact. We're okay. For as many as are led by the Spirit, these are the sons of God. And then he says, the Spirit himself bears witness with us that we are the children of God. God affirms us. God lets us know that we're okay, no matter what. And Corey said in those darkest times when she's standing for hours at attention in mud and water, in the cold, in the winter, half-starved, she would talk to God, and she knew that God was going to make her okay and that she was okay and there was a reason she was there. If Christ allowed it to happen, there was a reason. And not only that, but Christ is with us in the darkness. Christ is in us. He's with us. He lives through us. No matter what situation or external circumstance we find ourselves in, it's not about the external. It's about the internal. It's about the spiritual reality. If we are children, then heirs, heirs of God, and joint heirs with Christ. You know what that means? Joint heirs? It means that whatever Christ has inherited from the Father, you inherit also. Whatever Christ receives from the Father, what does he receive? Love, oneness, union, the kingdom. Receives the kingdom. Christ receives the kingdom. We're made part of that same kingdom. Jesus said the kingdom is within you. When we realize that, we start manifesting it. And that where we go, the kingdom goes. We're ambassadors of the kingdom. We don't belong to this world. We get caught up in it. We get distracted by it. We get full of
fear and angst and anxiety because of it, but it's not really where we're of, because we're of the Father. We're of the Spirit. Heirs of God and joint heirs with Christ, if indeed we suffer with him, that we may also be glorified together. Corey didn't end up with that mundane life. She suffered with Christ. She suffered for Christ. Why? I'm sure at times it seemed pointless. She questioned it over and over, and she found that it was so she could be Christ to other people, to Russians, to Poles, to Hungarians, to Jews, and even the Germans, who at that time were the oppressor. For I consider that the sufferings of this present time are not worthy to be compared with the glory which shall be revealed in us. The glory, as I read this book, that was revealed in Betsy and Corey Boom, is it's all hard to even comprehend, because in such dire circumstances, such misery, people dying in anguish all around, God's love came through that into that dark place. God placed them where they could be used by him to love other people. And in that loving, she witnessed the joy that her sister carried to her death. Malnourished, sick, died, concerned about other people to her last breath. And now Corey was all alone. She didn't have her beloved older sister with her. But Corey went on to not only survive that, she could have slipped back into the mundane life. Instead, she felt her heart to be for mentally challenged individuals that were treated even worse in the camps as subhuman or non-human, and ran a home for mentally challenged individuals, and went beyond that to go behind the Iron Curtain into the communist countries and help fledgling home churches that were secretly meeting at great risk to herself. Bring them Bibles. Did you know that there's people today in the world, when you think about it, that this will get them executed? This will get them tortured? This will get them put into prison that they may not come out of alive? Yeah, there's people dying today. There's people to take this word into places that are just as dangerous as the Third Reich was in the 1940s. It's a privilege that we have this word, that we still have this freedom. Believe it or not, we still have this freedom in this country, that we can meet openly like this. But a shadow has appeared on the scene. And there was a priest in Europe that was murdered for being a priest, for being about the gospel of Jesus Christ in 2016 in a so-called Western civilized nation, murdered in the church because he was about the Word of God. We have a false sense of security sometimes, because it's not a sense of security based on our Father. It's based on comfort, income, our own materialism, and that's an illusion. Paul goes on to tell us in verse 26, he says that likewise the Spirit also helps in our weaknesses, for we don't know what to pray for, but the Spirit himself makes intercession for us. Have you ever just not known? Have you ever gotten to the end of your own rope? God, I don't know how to help this person. I don't know. It's not working for them, and I've got nothing. The Spirit intercedes for us. God, I don't know what I need. I'm just frustrated. It's not working for me. The Spirit intercedes for us. And we know that all things work together for good to those who love God, to those who are called according to His purpose. Did you know you were called according to His purpose? Huh? That's right. For whom He foreknew, He also predestined to be conformed to the image of His Son. God is conforming us into the image of Christ so we can be Christ to someone else. So Christ can flow through us to someone else. Self-improvement? How about Christ improvement? But wait a minute, you can't improve on Christ. No, you can't. So maybe it's not about self-improvement at all. Maybe it's about allowing God to be God and to work through us by laying aside our self-will and being about His will. To be conformed to the image of His Son, that He might be the firstborn among many brethren. Did you know you are brothers and sisters of Jesus Christ? That's right. He's your big brother. He's my big brother. We have a dad, God the Father, and we have a big brother that will never let us down. Whom He predestined, He's talking about us as believers, these He also called, whom He called, these He also justified, and whom He justified, these He also glorified. We're glorified in Christ. We're glorified when we suffer for Christ. We're glorified when we lay our own will down and allow Him to lead us and to guide us into what He called us to do and to be. There's a master plan. All this history and all these world events that are taking place aren't just random stuff that's happening that's not connected. It's all connected. God foretold the end and a new beginning afterwards. God has it all in the palm of His hand, and it may seem chaotic, and it may at times be chaotic, but God is still in charge, and He knows what's happening. And those that are willing to be used by God will take part in it. Jesus said, talking about the harvest field, He said, the harvest is plenty, but the workers are few. What shall we say then? If God is for us, who can be against us? He who did not spare His own Son. God will never ask you to do anything that He didn't do Himself. God will never ask you to do anything that He's not right there with you in it and through it. He suffered alone. When they had to strip down for the weekly medical visit, which was nothing medical about it at all. They just had to walk naked in front of German soldiers. And she thought, how humiliating. And why would they even be interested in looking at these diseased, scrawny, half-starved people? And then the thought hit her. Jesus hung naked on the cross. Jesus has already done this. The artist put a little piece of cloth out of sensitivity. Jesus, Scripture tells, hung naked on that cross. There's nothing that we'll go through that He hasn't done. There's nothing we'll go through that He's not in there with us. But delivered Him up for us. How shall He not with Him also freely give us all things? God glorified Jesus, raised him up from the dead, seated him in the heavenlies. He does the same for us. Who shall bring a charge against God's elect? It is God who justifies. Who is it who condemns? It is Christ who died and furthermore is also risen, and furthermore, even at the right hand of God, who makes intercession for us. Who shall separate us from the love of God? Who shall separate us from the love of Christ? Shall tribulation or distress or persecution or famine or nakedness or peril or sword? Yet in all these things we are more than conquerors. Through him who loved us, our victory is in Christ. We conquer in him and through him as he uses us for his good purpose. For I am persuaded that neither death nor life, nor angels, nor principalities, nor powers. Some people are so afraid of demons, of bad spiritual things. But listen to this. Neither death, nor life, nor angels, nor principalities, nor powers, nor things present, nor things to come. You don't have to be afraid of the future. Nor height, nor depth, nor any other created thing shall be able to separate us from the love of God which is in Christ Jesus, our Lord. Our Lord, our big brother. Nothing can separate us. Not even an extermination camp can't separate us from the love of Christ. The kingdom's within. He's in us, living in us and through us. Maybe it's time we start relying on him.
All right. It's amazing that the word gospel is good news, right? Did you hear any good news here? Bob mentioned it earlier. You didn't receive a spirit of bondage again unto fear. Let's put that in today's language. God's not saying do it or else. See, unfortunately, that has become the message of a whole lot of churches. You better do this or else. If you're not doing this and you're not doing that, then God's going to punish you. And, you better not do this, and you certainly ought to do that. And if you don't, then, well, see, what's really going on there is you're having consequences for you choosing your way over God's way. That's really what's going on. You can do it your way. Jim made a comment, hey, God, I'm going to do this. Can you bless it now? And we wonder why we get in trouble. But I want to bring a few characters in. Rusty's back there. Rusty had an experience, it's a year or so ago, hit by an SUV, and as he's flying through the air, Bob mentioned this too. There's this big master plan. Everything happens for a reason, right, Russ? Everything happens for a reason. And I find that when I get frustrated with situations, when I get frustrated with people, and I want to go in and clean house, and I want to go in and make something happen, it won't be pretty, I promise. When I do it in my strength, I'm fearful of going to jail, if I get honest. But when I lay back and I pray about it, and Patty and I, here's another character we can bring in. Patty and I just had this talk back there. She says, I found out that if we're patient, God's work is going to get done. Just lay back. I'm not saying lay back and do nothing, but be aware that there is a bigger plan in the midst of your trials. Everything happens for a reason. Some of your frustrations that you want to handle, if you handle them on your own, where would you be? It won't be pretty. But if I lay back and go, okay, God, I'm not sure why this is happening, but I know there's a reason. And you say, even when it looks like it's meant to harm me, that you're going to work it for my good. So do your stuff. Out of the conversation I had with Patty, it brought me right back to a childhood memory where my dad would have me helping him work on the car. Anybody do that as a kid? Yeah. How many times did you hear, will you get your hands out of the way? Just get, if you move your hand, I'll be able to get in there and do it. I heard that over and over, and I relate it now to God. You know, if your hands are in there trying to do God's work, he's not going to be rude, and he's not going to yell at you. He's not going to smack you beside the head with the wrench like I used to get once in a while. Get your hands out of the way. Get your hands out of God's way and let him do his work. He's the master mechanic. Hold the light. How about that one? I always got hold the light. Over here. Over here. Smack. Never mind. Give me that thing. Let's start at the top. Having been born of the Spirit, which is what happened when you accepted Christ, having been born of the Spirit, you accept the gift of salvation, you are a child of God. You haven't been given the spirit of fear again unto bondage. You have been given the spirit of adoption. Now, it's interesting that they use the word adoption because in the biblical days back then, if you were a real blood son and you did something that ticked off dad bad enough, he could actually disown you. But if you were an adopted son, adopted was for life. It didn't end. You couldn't excommunicate an adopted child. So once you've been accepted into the family, you are have been given the spirit of adoption, whereby you have the honor and blessing to call God dad. Hey, dad, thanks for taking me in. Get it? Okay, I'm working in there. My father affirms me as his child. We're going to get to the timeout for the trip in at the end. I am the apple of his eye. I've heard a bunch of stuff out on Facebook especially. You know, if God had a refrigerator, my picture would be on it. And yours would too. If God had a wallet, your photo would be in his wallet. He's proud of his son. He loves his children. That's where we are in God's presence, okay? If I suffer with Christ, then I'll be glorified with him. That was interesting that God's already gone through all these things, and we think he doesn't get it. Well, he doesn't understand what it's like to be me. But yeah, he does. The Spirit comforts me and strengthens me. It's a CNC there, comforts and strengthens. In the middle of my trials, when I don't understand what's going on, God, what is going on here? Help me. We talk about how the Spirit directly intercedes, okay? And this, I hate to use this term because, unfortunately, attorneys and lawyers have kind of gotten bad press because they're not all really good and they're not all really about helping their clients. A lot of them are about helping themselves to our money and getting what they can. But this guy is our perfect attorney who stands in intercession for us with dad. There was a word that I put down that Bob mentioned. Oh, yeah. Jesus is there in our defense. God, you know their flesh. You know what they're made of. You know that they're all elements of the earth, that you took them off the earth and you breathed life into them. You know that they have this flesh that doesn't understand. And you already forgave them. Remember, Dad? It's already done. Love, 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 love all the time. In relationship with God and Christ and the Spirit. I am being molded into the very likeness of Christ. I use this an awful lot in my counseling sessions, and I've said it here. When you accept this Spirit into you, what is placed in you is the seed of Christ. If you plant a seed of tomatoes, it grows tomatoes. You plant a seed of corn, it grows corn. You have the seed of Christ. It's going to grow Christ. In you. You and Bob said it perfectly. I'm glad he didn't say Christ-likeness. You will be Christ to somebody. You may be the only God somebody sees. How we love people is how we love God. It's just the way it is. God is for me and with me always. I love the other one that said, God is close at hand. Put your hand out. That's pretty close. God is always close at hand. He's for me. He's with me always. As God's own child, no charge against me will stand. And if somebody thinks it will, Jesus is there interceding. No, no, no. That one's already forgiven. That one's already come home. That one's already ours, God. And I love that Bob mentioned that some people freak out about these other spirits and what could be happening, and maybe somebody put a spell on me, and maybe there's demons. I keep trying to remind people all the time, if the Satan himself came at me with an attack, all I would have to do is speak the name of Jesus, and he has to flee, has to flee. If his demons or his workmen or his whatever they're called are trying to put some kind of a hoax on me or some kind of a hex or something, I don't have to worry, because the Bible says this, be filled with the Spirit always. That's not you filling yourself with the Spirit. It's allowing yourself to be filled with the Spirit always. And if you're full of the Spirit, is there any room for anybody? Is there any room for Satan? Is there any power in somebody throwing some kind of hex at you? Absolutely not. You're filled with the Spirit of Jesus. Speaking his name will cast him off. But knowing that you have nothing to fear because you're surrounded. Why do we freak out? Fear. False evidence appearing real. Oh my God, I think this is going to happen, and I think that's going to happen, and this might happen, and oh my God, that might happen. And what if, and what if, and what if? What'd Bob say about even the worries of the future? There's nothing that God can't do. Yeah, but, you got your butt in the way again. Yeah, but, I love the yeah, buts. I was famous for being miserable. I had a furrow in my brow. I was stressed all the time. I was worried about how am I going to do this? What's going to happen? What's going to happen there? I'm going to bring another little quote in. Holly over here this morning. I hope you're okay with me making you in the spotlight. She walked out front. I said, look at you. You're absolutely sparkling. And she said, well, yeah, I'm in love. Now think about this. If you're in God's love, what do you think Corrie Ten Boom looked like in the middle of that dark place? Do you think she was a light? You think she was sparkling? In spite of her situation, she had this faith. And I've had people tell me this, and I'm like, no. There's something about you. Bob said it. There was something about you. Well, yeah, I'm sparkling. I'm in love. I know I'm secure. I know I'm safe. I know that God's got me. What else are you going to do? Well, I think I'll worry. I think I'll fret. I think I'll freak out. No, you don't have to when you know you're secure in God. And nobody can steal that from you. Nobody. Nobody. Since Christ already won the victory, I'm a winner. Bob put it this way, we're more than conquerors. Well, what's a conqueror? A conqueror goes in and he vanquishes the enemy. Hee-hee! We won. John Glenn puts a more than conqueror this way. Here's a more than conqueror. You vanquish the enemy and you set captives free. Kind of Rambo stuff, ain't it? Rambo, I want you to go in there. There's people still in that prison camp. Get them out. Hee-hee! Now we're talking. That's a more than conqueror. Not only are you saved, but God's going to use you to reach other people who aren't. You will be Christ to somebody. Well, greater works than he will you do. Well, Jesus brought people back to life. You know how many people in 11 years here at Archie's I've seen come to life when they accepted the gift of Christ? Well, Jesus gave people sight. Do you know how many people over 11 years I've seen go from walking blind spiritually to saying, wow, I never knew? You know how many people are in the church walking blind? Thinking that if I just show up on Sunday, if I just do my studies on Wednesday, if I pray every morning, if I do this, if I do that, if I do this, if I do that, then God will bless me. God, are you noticing me yet? Without faith, they're doing a whole bunch of works. But faith without works is dead, brother. Yeah, you know what's worse? Works without faith is still dead. If you're doing all your works thinking God's going to give you a bonus tab at the end of your life, That's not faith. That's works. Works without faith is dead, and it's killing people. But I did this, and I did that, and then the people in the church hurt me. Well, people are going to hurt you. I expressed to a new friend here, Dennis. Dennis, do you mind me waving you out? Dennis came in today. I told him, hey, make yourself around. We're just like family. And by saying just like family, it doesn't mean we're all going to get along. We're just like a family. Make yourself known. Say hello. There's brothers and sisters here. Some you're going to get along with. Some are going to get the kids at school to gang up and beat you up on Tuesday when you show up. I don't know if that's just my family life, but hey. Bob mentioned that Jesus is our big brother. But he's the big brother who's going to defend us. He's the big brother that we can count on. He's the big brother that'll never fail us. All good stuff. I am in the palm of God's hands. And that's the way it's put in the scripture. And once you're in the palm of God's hands, hear this, nobody can snatch you out of it. Not even you. You can't be bad enough to get God to spit you out. And I'm not telling you to go ahead and do whatever the heck you want, but I want you to notice how your wants change when you start trusting God. I want you to notice how all of a sudden the things of this world start to fade away. There's a song that we never sing here, and it's only because we haven't found the background words for it, the text for it, but turn your eyes upon Jesus, look full in his wonderful face, and the things of this world will grow strangely dim in the light of his glory and grace. When you understand how important it is to have this awesome relationship with God, stuff becomes stuff. And in so many recovery situations you hear, don't sweat the small stuff. Oh, and it's all small stuff. Well, that's easy to say when you're just trying to convince yourself. But when you realize the big stuff is God, all the rest is small stuff. It fades. So what if I'm not wealthy? So what if I didn't hit the Powerball? So what if I live in a simple little house? I have joy. I have peace that nobody can rob. I have a place that I can find my sanctuary. And it's not, you know, when I go to the beach, it's peaceful. But when I leave the beach, peace is at the beach. Peace is here. Rest is here. The kingdom of God is within. Ah. Wow, it's nice to be free. Wow, it's nice to know that God's got me. Wow. Yeah, but what if, there you go again. Throw it away. When you start hearing the yeah buts, throw it away. It's killing you. It's killing you. Who shall bring a charge against me? God's elect. Who? Who do you think is here to condemn you? I said it last week and the week before. It doesn't make sense. Who do you think is condemning you? The one who came to save you? Why are we so confused with that? Who do you think is causing guilt and shame in your life when Jesus came to remove guilt and shame? Who's laying this guilt trip on you? Is it you? Is it somebody in the church? Is it somebody who you think loves you? Or is it somebody just trying to manipulate you? It's not God. You're free. And those who are free in Christ are free indeed. What does that mean? Keep coming back. We're going to start up toward the end of August, I think. I don't remember the date, the 30th or 31st, whatever that last Wednesday is in August. We're going to start doing the Alpha Series, an in-depth study again at the thrift store on Wednesday nights. Wednesdays at 7. I meant to have it in the bulletin here today. We'll do it next week. I'd like you to commit to coming for 9 weeks straight and get this in-depth. All of this stuff that we teach here is what we've learned in-depth through the Alpha Series, and it will strengthen your faith. It'll bring you to a point where it puts, actually, there's a couple people that I've got going through it. They said it's really neat that there's actually a diagram that helps me to understand what it really means to be in faith and to walk in Christ and to know that I'm free and to know that I'm okay. What changed in my life? why I don't have the scowl on my face, why I don't have the stress, why I don't have the worries. I actually had a psychic guy tell me, your aura is absolutely amazing. It's just glowing. And I'm like, to me, that's kind of wacky and weird because I never believed in, like, psychic stuff. But I said, you know, the only thing I could answer was one thing. You know what? That's the spirit of Jesus. It's not me. I have this spirit in me. And what else am I going to do but glow? What else would you do? I'm in love. I'm in his love. I'm in his hand. I'm in his plan. And I trust him. That's the hardest part. The last one. That's your job. Trust. Shameless plug. My book's here. Trusting him is where I found freedom. Not trying. Not thinking I was saved. Not hoping I was saved. But knowing it and trusting it is where the rubber meets the road. So let's walk through this time out for the trip in. What kind of things do you think God wants to say to you? You know how many times I've asked that question and heard, well, he wants me to tell me to stop doing this. He wants me to straighten up. He wants me to change my language. He wants me to, you know, do this and do that and maybe study more. And it's incorrect. Whatever you think God is trying to say to you, think about it for a minute. What do you think God wants to say to you? That it should clean up? Here's one. God cleans his fish after he catches them. I've heard so many times, I got to get my life straightened out and get back to church. Well, why don't you get back to church and let God straighten your life out? Well, I don't know if he'll accept me. There is not a person on the face of this earth that Jesus Christ did not die for. Not one. That means you're invited. Are these words that you think God is trying to say to you encouragement? Are they accusations? Are they condemnations? Or is he uplifting and loving? Now let's add to that. Bob and I discuss this. Mark and I discuss it pretty regular. When God speaks to us, he speaks in the fruits of the Spirit. Love, patience, kindness, gentleness, mercy, peace. Huh. My sheep hear my voice and they trust me. Anybody ever have a boss that all they did was make sure you were there on time and make sure you did your work and they really didn't care about you as long as their work was done? Yeah. You hear his voice, but you surely don't trust him, do you? That's what a taskmaster is. My sheep hear my voice and they trust me because I know that what that shepherd has is a safe place for me. Because I know he's going to, you might remember these words, lead me beside still waters. Where the grass is healthy and good. Where I know I'm safe. I know I can trust him. He's going to do what's best for me. I know it. So, check it out. This last one is for you. Maybe you want to cut it out and put it on your mirror in your car. Well, don't put it on the rearview mirror. Put it at home in your bathroom or something. I am an awesome spirit being of magnificent worth in whom God is well pleased, just the way you are. Why? Because you're his kid. Why? Because he knows everything there is to know about you. If you get yourself in trouble, he's going to try and reach you more with love. He's not going to disown you. If you think you're not good enough, you're believing a lie. He has made you worthy. He has made you glad. He has accepted you. He knows your flaws. Let him work on them. Life gets better. I'm living proof. And I'm far from perfect. Ask my wife. I am far from perfect. Ask Mark. He knows. He's over there laughing out loud. I am far from perfect. And I have this weird sense of humor. But you know what? God loves me. And it changed my life to know that I'm loved. I say it so many times in jail. All of us think we're just the biggest, baddest dudes and we don't need love. You're wrong. Every one of us needs to be loved. Everyone is longing for the voice of a Savior to say, it's okay, just like you are. As we close in a word of prayer, I'm not sure who's set up for communion, but I bet somebody is because we have a great team in place. Thanks, girls. Right back there by the trash cans. So while you're back there, if you've never accepted this gift of salvation, go on back there, throw some of your old stuff away, and pick up something new. How about that one? You're invited to the table to accept. You don't have to be part of this denomination. You don't have to be a member of this church. It has nothing to do with it. If you step up and say, God, I want what you've got for me, it's just that simple. You're accepting his body broken for you. You're accepting his blood that was spilled for the forgiveness of your sins, which are acts against God. And you're choosing to walk in faith. Take that spirit in. Let God lead you to learn more. Matter of fact, if you take that spirit in, you're going to be hungry for more. That was my experience. I couldn't get enough. I had to figure out what this God thing was all about. And stop trying to perform for God. Walk in faith. Listen to his voice and do what he says. Heavenly Father, this morning, as we know, as some of us know, some of us still aren't quite assured, we're in your hand. You have a plan for us. We know that no matter how horrible it seems, the bigger picture is in your control. Not that you control us like puppets, but we know that we can trust you. Everything happens for a reason. Maybe I'm sitting on this deck today for a reason. Maybe you're calling me. If that's the case, God, give me the boldness to say yes. Give me the boldness to be honest and say I'm done. Help me to put aside my yeah buts and to seek a God who loves when I didn't even think I needed it. To seek a God who forgave 2,000 years ago, and all I have to do is accept it. Today, God, I seek you, and I want a deeper relationship now. I ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. All right, a couple of songs we're going to finish up with. I hope nobody minds rock and roll because I try to end on a rock and roller at the end. I'm not asking forgiveness, just warning you. Hey, where's that guitar, Mark? Oh, thank you.
Every move I make in you. You make me move, Jesus. Every breath I take, I breathe in you. Every step I take in you. You are my way, Jesus. Every breath I take, I breathe in you. Every move I make in you. You make me move, Jesus. Every breath I take, I breathe in you. Every step I take in you. You are my way, Jesus. Every breath I take, I breathe in you.
All right, if you don't know the words, this one will be easy for you. We're gonna do just like we were little kids. Na 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 na. Only we're gonna do it different. Ready?
Na 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 na. Ways of grace. Every move I make in you. You make me move, Jesus. Every breath I take, I breathe in you. Every step I take in you. You are my way, Jesus. Every breath I take, I breathe in you.
Okay, let's make fun of each other one more time.
Na 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 na.
Four more times. I think this song might have been Jesus' prayer. Let there be peace on earth.
Peace that was meant to be.
I warned you. What? At church?
Yeah, my life's been a breeze since I met Jesus Christ, my Lord. Christ my Lord. I said my life's been a breeze since I gave Jesus Christ my soul. Yeah, he's my Lord and Savior. He softened up my heart's stone. I said my life's been a breeze since I made Jesus Christ my Lord. I said my life's been a breeze since I gave Jesus Christ my soul. Yeah, he's my Lord and Savior. He softened up my heart's stone.
Makes it a breeze. See, you don't have to, you get to. It's good news. God bless you. Have a great Sunday. Be safe out there. I hope to have the new box truck here and on display next week. We'll see how God opens up my time to do so.